So let's talk about shared decision making and switching.
Of course, we would like to, we need to involve our patients in the treatment decision. We need to offer them the options, our recommended strategies perhaps, but take into account a phrase that Les is fond of saying, their values and preferences. So we're always doing a risk-benefit analysis, right? And as we've showed you, there are differences in the risk, particularly for certain kinds of risks. So you're always taking that into account. And you want to know certain specific things. What exact condition are we treating? Turns out that, for instance, patients with schizophrenia tend to be a little more tolerant of certain side effects than mood disorder patients. So that may come into this. What specific symptoms am I trying to treat? As I mentioned earlier, some of the drugs may be more calming, some more activating. We want to know their history of their medications and how it went. We want to know comorbidity. We want to know their metabolic risk. Concomitant medications is a big one. There are drug-drug interactions we didn't talk about. Some, they're metabolized differently, and so some drug-drug interactions are more relevant than others. And then the shared decision-making, of course, patient-centered approach to making decisions. Instead of us being paternalistic and dictating to the patient, we need to involve them. And there's a lot of research that outcomes are better, adherence is better when the patient is involved in the decision-making process.
So this is evidence-based practice. It means taking into account your clinical judgment, the relevant scientific evidence out there, and your patient's values and preferences. It's not a cookbook, and it requires us to know as much as we can about the old and the new, and know all we can find out from our patients. Switches offer both opportunity and risk. So you may actually have a patient who responds more poorly with what you switch to. That's always going to be a risk. But keep in mind, a medicine doesn't have to be absolutely perfect. It has to relieve symptoms well enough, tolerated well enough, and that the patient has to be willing to take it. I also need to address any unrealistic expectations the patient will have. And the way to do this is with shared decision making and motivational interviewing. If I just write a prescription and say, here, go fill it, it's not going to go very far. I need to identify what they want to work on, what symptoms they are concerned about. It may not be the same symptoms I'm concerned about.
That's right.
They may have different ideas there. And I have to figure out from the array of choices I offer them, you know, I need to be mindful about what I'm offering. And then once they pick something or collaboratively agree to take something, then I'm ahead of the game.
Yeah.
Because they'll be more inclined to go along with the plan if they have actively participated in it.
I certainly find not only are symptoms important, which symptoms matter to the patient, but often aspects of quality of life and function are very important to a patient. So understanding their particular hobbies, interests, what their roles are, that can also be very helpful in monitoring treatment.